So, in the last class, I was talking about this concept called polymorphism. So, polymorphism, so wherever you check, the definition remains same. It means more than one form. That means, see here, the polymorphism can also be of two types. One is like the compile-time polymorphism, and other one is like runtime polymorphism. Like it's like exhibiting two different characteristics. So in C++, polymorphism is of two types. One is the compile-time polymorphism, and the other one is runtime polymorphism. So an example of compile-time polymorphism can be an function overloading, and an example of runtime polymorphism can be the virtual function. But usually, we will study the function overloading first. We'll study the function overloading as an example of compile time polymorphism. After that, we can go with this operator overloading, virtual functions. So, what is this function overloading means? Whenever two or more functions are having the same name, like function will be having the same name but different number of parameters or different data types for parameters, so that you can take it as that you can take it as an example of the function overloading. So here in function overloading, the function name will be same, the function name will be same, but the data types can be different. Like for example, if the function parameter, the for the first function called add function, if it is having the integer data type, means for the I'm talking about if it contains only two parameters. For example, one second, I'll just show. This is visible, right? The screen is visible, some notepad screen.
Yes, sir.
For example, function overloading can be like there is one function called add function. So for this, it contains only two parameters of integer data type. So if I write one more function with the same name but different number of parameters, instead of two parameters I will pass three parameters. So this is also an example of function overloading. Now these functions are said to be overloaded, or I don't like that, so I'll write float, a function to perform the addition of floating point number. So this is also an example. So either the number of parameters should be different. Here in our case, I am using two parameters to perform addition of two numbers, to perform addition of two number three numbers, or the data type should be different. The data type should be different. Here it will perform the addition of two floating point numbers, but this will perform the addition of two integer number. So this we will call it as the function overloading. Function will have the same name but it can have different number of parameters or different data types. So we will call this as the function overloading. So this is one of the examples. So this is one of the example of polymorphism. So one more example, we will call it as operator overloading. So operator overloading means, you know that there is a symbol called plus. So plus is used to perform addition. So plus can be used to perform the addition of numbers. But using operator overloading, you can use the same function plus to join two strings. In usually in C++, you will use plus symbol to join two strings. So that is an example. That is an example of overloading. Here in addition to the in see here C in C++, this plus operator with respect to its basic function addition, it is able to perform extra characteristics, like it is able to join two strings. We know that plus is used for addition, means adding two numbers. When that is like, for example, like if I write it as 2 plus 3, you know that plus is used to add this number 2 and 3, and the output will be 5. But when I'm using the same thing between A, B, C, plus def. So it will join these two strings. The output will be like abcdef. So it is used for the joining of two strings. So that is the example of operator overloading. So after this, there is one more thing called see this these two was regarding these two examples, like one, this is an example of function overloading. So this is an example of operator overloading. So these two will come under compile type.
So once again, you explain function overloading, sir.
Function overloading, okay. I'll just clear the screen and I'll just explain. See, function overloading means the function will have same name. So function overloading means function will have same name, but different parameters that can be in number or in type. For example, I'll write a function called add function. So here for this add function, I'll use two integer parameters. Here the parameter is integer. So this function will perform the addition of two integer number. So when I'm using the same function name with different number of parameters, like in this example, I was using two parameters. In this example, I will be using three parameters. So this is also an example of function overloading. It will perform three integer number addition. Even I can give the same name, but different number or like different type. Like here I was using the integer data type, but here I will use the float data type. So it is taking two numbers, but the data type is float. So these are the examples. The function is having the same name. The function is having the same name, but different number of parameters. Here it is taking two parameter, here it is taking three parameter, or different type for each parameter. Here it is taking the float data type, here it is taking the integer data type. So this is an example of function overloading. Is it understood?
Yes.
Like either it can be the number of arguments or the type. See, type means data types. So this function, this we will call it as function overloading. This we will call it as function overloading. So this we will call it as function overloading. And I give an example of operator plus. So it is having two characteristics. One is for addition and another one for concatenation. Concatenation means joining of strings. So this you can call it as operator overloading. So these two category will come under compile time polymorphism. And there is one more thing called runtime polymorphism. So for runtime polymorphism, one example can be like function overloading can be an example of this runtime polymorphism. So what happens means for example there will be a function in some base class that will be overrided by the function in child class. So here there will be one function in base class. So that function will be overloaded within the child class. So this is an example of function overloading. For example, I think we have already studied this, but a little modification is that I told you, whenever there is one class called animal, and there is one class called dog. Both the classes are having the same function called eat, but the preference will be given to derived class. But the preference was given to the derived class. The same way, the same thing. But here, what we will do means we will just make some changes. We'll make some changes in which the derived class function will be like the derived class function will override the base class function. So this concept we'll call it as function overloading. So we'll work out this with some example also. As of now, you should be clear with what is polymorphism, like what are the types of polymorphism in C++. So after this, we can execute the same thing. With programming example also. Is this point clear? Whether
yes, sir.
It outs in polymorphism. If not, we will start implementing that. We'll start writing a code for checking the compile time polymorphism and runtime polymorphism also. So we can start writing that. So shall we start?
So yes, sir.
If you don't have any doubts, we'll go with that. We'll go with the examples then. So first one, first one is compile time polymorphism. So in compile time polymorphism, we'll just take an example of addition function. We'll just take up an example of addition function. IOStream dot. Now, what I told, first I'll create one class called demo. So I'll make it as public. So functions will have same name, but different number of arguments or different types of arguments. So those things will come under polymorphism. For example, void add. So here it will take integer a comma integer b. So it will perform addition of a plus b. After this, it will print the value. Addition of a and b. Then C. So this is one thing. So now I'll use the same function to perform addition of three numbers. Function name is same. Add integer a comma integer b comma integer c. So what it will do, it will perform addition of three numbers. Integer d is equal to a plus b plus c. And I'll just print sum of three numbers. Then what is the sum? D. The result is stored in D. Again, I'll write the same thing. Void add. Here I will use float data type. Float a, float b. So float a, float b. Integer c. It should not be integer. It should be float because I'm performing the addition of floating point numbers. So since I'm performing the addition of floating point numbers, I should write it as float c is equal to a plus b. After that, c out sum of floating value a and b is, then sum is stored in C. So see, one thing I'll just explain this code. You just look into that. So what I'm doing means here I'm just writing, I'm just creating a class called demo class. I'm creating a class called demo class. Inside this, I am using three functions, but the function name is same. The function name is same, addition, but the first function is performing addition of two numbers. The second function is performing addition of three numbers. The third function is performing the addition of two floating point numbers. You can check that here. You can check that in when we compare the first and second function, their function name is same. Data type is also same, but the parameters count is different. The first one will perform the addition of two numbers. The second one will perform the addition of three numbers. When I compare the first function with the third function, the name is same, but here parameter is also same. It is also performing the addition of two numbers. The third function is also performing the addition of two numbers, but data type is different. The first one will perform the addition of integers. The third one will perform the addition of float. So this thing, these things, we will call it as the function overloading. Function has the same name, but different number of parameters or different types of parameters. So after this main function, no integer main, then it should return some value. Now I'll create the object. What is the class name? Class name is demo. I'll create some object called db. I'll just create as db. So if I write db dot add, so I want to perform the addition of integers, which are like the addition of two numbers. I can pass it as 5, 10. I can write it as 5, 10. So now if I write like this, what will be the output? I'll build this. So I don't have any error, no errors. So I'll run this. If I run this, I'm getting the addition of A and B is 15. That means the first line, the addition of A and B. So this function is getting executed. So the same thing now what I will do, the same line I will copy. We'll call this 5, 70, 95. So something, some value. So now I'm calling the second function, addition of three integer number. So I'll build this. I'll run this. So one small modification I'll just make. I'll just add the new line character. I'll just add the new line character so that the output will look easier. Like it will be easy to look. So okay. So now see, function name is same. The first one, it is performing the addition of two numbers. In the second case, it is executing the second one, the sum of three numbers. It is executing the sum of three numbers. It is executing the sum of three numbers, so that you can check. So sum of three numbers is 100. So I want to execute one more thing, floating point addition. I can write that also, db dot add of tell me some floating point numbers, 15.45, 76.16. so some random number. So I'll run now, build, no errors. Why I'm getting an error? Okay. See, by default, I had given the value as 15.0. No, in C++, that 15.0 will be considered as the double data type. So if you want to make it as float data type, you have to specify it as float by using the letter F. So I'd given 15.45. It had taken that 15.45 as the default data type, that as the double data type. So for that, I just converted into floating. So if I run this, see, I'm getting 91.61. So the function name is same. The function is same only. The function is having the same name. So the function is having the same name, but it is exhibiting different characteristics. One time it is performing the addition of two numbers, one time it is performing the addition of three numbers, and the other time it is performing the addition of three numbers. So this is an example, because the function name is same. The function name is add, but it is acting differently in three different scenarios. So the function name, what is the function name? Here also the function name is add. Here also the function name is add. Here also the function name is add, but it is acting differently. It is having different characteristics. One time addition of two numbers, the other time addition of three numbers, and the other time the addition of two numbers, but their data type is float. So this we will call it as function overloading. So this is one of the example of polymorphism. Is this clear? Is this point clear? Yes or no? Any doubts? Can anyone tell? If you have any doubts, you can just let me know now itself. Yes or no? Any doubts?
So scroll it down, sir, for a second.
Okay, I'll just scroll it down. One second, I'll just any doubts? See, the function name is same. The function name is same, but it is executing three different characteristics. So I'll just reduce this. If it pause, it will not be possible to write. It is not possible to display that in a single screen. So I'll just try to reduce that, reduce the size so that you can check. Is this visible? This is a function. This is a function which I've written. Okay. This is a class in which I've written three functions and the main function which I'm calling. I'll just write it in a single. Now it will be visible. Any doubt? Any doubt here? You're understanding, right? The how?
Yes, sir.
This is an example of compile time polymorphism. So we have the same way. Even we can do the operator overloading also. So that is a separate concept, which since I'm giving an example of polymorphism, like a function overloading as an example for polymorphism, I'm just explaining this concept. The same way we have operator overloading also, that is also an example of compile time polymorphism and function overriding also. So first we will, there is one concept called virtual functions. So once that is clear, we'll take those two examples. So I'll, in a separate class, we'll take the example of operator overloading and function overloading. So as of now, as an example to understand the polymorphism, I've given this function overloading as the example. So if anything question comes with related to the polymorphism, you can explain this. So if you have any doubts regarding this compile time polymorphism and function overloading, you can just let me know. If not, we'll go with the next class. We'll just proceed with the next concept. Is this point clear? Yes or no? See, I need at least interaction should be there. Then only I can understand, or at least I can assume that you're able to understand.
Sir.
Okay. So now, so this, like we were talking about four main things in object-oriented concepts. One was the inheritance, the second one was data abstraction, data encapsulation, and polymorphism. So after this we'll look for the few more concepts. So this is just a slide where the same thing, whatever was in the slide, I've just written, but I've not taken the string example. I've taken the integer parameter with three different arguments as an example. So after this, the same thing, the function where we told like the types of polymorphism and what will come under the compile time polymorphism and what will come under the runtime polymorphism. So now after this, we are in the initial classes. We spoke about the variables. In the initial classes, we spoke about the variables, but now there is one variable. Now we'll check what is this reference variable? What is this reference variable? How it will work in C? So what is this reference variable? What will happen if I write this line? We can check in detail. So we'll just talk about the reference variable. I'll just erase this. See, one thing is like, you know that the operating system will maintain the address of each variable. So once you declare a variable called integer A, so for that variable, inside the memory, some memory will be allocated. So operating system will give some address. For example, I'll take the address of this variable as 1000. So at some address called 1000, for this variable called a memory will be allocated during the runtime of that program. And also, if I want to access this variable a means, the first thing is I should find the address of a, then only I can access them. So if I know the address of a, then only I can access them. So one thing is the operating system will maintain the address of each variable. So that is what it is written. So yeah, the operating system is maintaining the address, like it is giving some address called 1000. Here I'm assuming the address to be 1000 for this variable called k. So, and a memory is allocated for this variable. Memory is allocated for this variable at the address 1000. So if you want to access this variable a means the first thing is you should get the address of this variable. So then only you can be able to access that variable called a. Is this point clear? So if you declare a variable, the address will be stored. So if here I'm declaring the variable called integer a, for that at address 1000 the memory will be allocated. So if I want to access this variable a means the first thing is I should get the address 1000. If I get the address 1000, then only I can access this variable a. So now what will happen for the line? I'm writing a line called x is equal to y. So what will happen if this line is executed? So we are assuming that both x and y are of integer data type. So if this following statement is being executed, the first thing is you know that the value of this variable will be copied to x. For example, integer y is equal to 10. If I write x is equal to y means in the what it will happen, it is like assigning x is equal to 10. So you know that the value of this y will be copied to the variable x. So the same way, so what happens means the first step. So first step, what will happen means when this line is executed means the operating system will find the address of y. Why it should find the address of y means just now we spoke. So if I want to access a means I should get the address of a, then only I can access. The same way, if I want to know what value is there in this variable y means the first thing is I should get the address of y. So the first thing the operating system will do means it will find the address of y. Once the address is found, it will transfer the control to the byte whose address is matching, like with this address. So whatever is the address of y, with the address that is matching, the OS will transfer the control to the byte whose address is matching with the y address. So after that, the first thing is check the address of y. After that, transfer the control to the byte where the address is matching with the y's address. The third step will be copy the value. Copy the value present at that address. Copy the value. In our example, copy the value from the block where the address is stored. For example, if I'd stored some value called 50, so it will get the address. It is like Y. It is present at some location 1050 and it is having a value called 5. So first it will get the address of Y. So after that, the control will be transferred. Then it will copy the value which is there at this address 1050. So we know that the operating system will read the value from this block, So that means the third step is copying the value or reading the value, reading Y value. After reading this value will be sent to stack. Operating system will send this value to stack. By this time, you should have some understanding about the stack and all. It follows first in, last out, or last in, first out. So you should be clear with the stack. I need not explain what do you mean by stack and all. So the operating system will copy the value to the stack, or it will push the value to the stack. So after this, now the right hand side operation is clear. First you read the value of Y, like first you called the address of Y. After that you transfer the control to that location. So from that location, one block was there. From that block you have read the value of Y and you have stored that value inside the stack. For example, in our example, you are storing that value called 5 in a stack. So after that, the next step involves with respect to X. Now you want to copy this value. Now see X, Y. So Y, 5 is there. So right hand side, it is clear. You got the address of Y, then you transfer the control, then you copied the value. After that, you are storing that value in some stack. You are storing that value in some stack. But I need that value to be copied to X. So if I want to copy to X, the first thing is I should find the address of X. I will take X as 2000. First thing is the fifth step will be to the operating system will find address of X. Once the address of X is found out, again it will transfer the control. Again it will transfer the control which matches to this byte address. So after that the seventh step. So get the address of this X. After that, transfer the control, then copy the value which is there in temporary stack. Copy the value which is in the temporary stack and put it in X thing. So the operating system will copy the value from the stack and it will place it inside the block which is referenced by the 100 2000. So this is how the value will be copied. So if you write one simple statement X is equal to Y, so these steps are involved in that. So the right hand side variable value will be copied to the right hand side value, but the address of both the variables has to be found out. You have to find the address of right hand side variable as well as the address of left hand side variable for performing the assignment operations. Is it clear? Yes or no?
Yes, sir.
See, fine, right? You're able to understand, right? See, one common terminology is like, so I'll just write here. The first four steps are similar, okay? X, Y. First, get the address of X. Sorry, get the address. I'm writing X is equal to Y. Get the address of Y. After that, transfer the control. Once the control is transferred, read the value. Once the value is read, place it in a stack. After that, four steps are clear for the right hand side operation. After this, get the value of X. Once the value of X is once the address of this X is being read, then transfer the control. Once you transfer the control, next you want to, here you are copying the value from this block, but here you have to place the value. So if you want to place the value, get it from the stack and place it here. So that's all. So these are the steps that are involved in reading whenever the simple statement is executed. So this is one statement. So I just wanted to tell what will happen if you just execute a simple statement x is equal to y. So now why we are talking about this variable means. So now we will be talking about the reference variable. So what is this reference variable? So reference variable means it will share so already there is a variable. For that variable, this reference variable will act as an it is like a reference for that variable, for an existing variable. So already one variable A is there. So for that variable A, this reference variable will act as a reference. So that means reference in the sense it will share the same memory location. So that we will call it as reference variable. By definition, reference variable means it is a reference for an existing variable. What is this reference means? It is sharing the same memory location as of an existing variable. There will be existing variable that existing for that existing variable, it will share the same memory location. Now, what is the syntax? Now, what is the syntax of this reference variable? What is the syntax, or how do we know it? I'll just open this. So how to determine a variable as reference variable? So I told you that reference variable means it is nothing but a reference for an existing variable. It will share the memory of an existing variable. How to make the variable as a reference means, the first thing is syntax. So what is the syntax? What is the syntax for this reference variable means? The first one is data type, then ampersand symbol, reference variable name, the reference variable name, then assignment operator, existing variable. So I told you that reference variable means it is nothing but a reference for an existing variable. Already the variable is existing. So for this variable, you are creating a reference variable which will point to the same memory location as the existing variable. For the existing variable, some memory will be there. So that memory location will be referenced by this reference variable. Like it is sharing the memory location. So we'll go with some example. So I'll take float sum total is equal to 100. So inside the memory block, sum, I'll take it as 1000. So the name is given as total, and it is taking the value 100. So value 100 is there inside this block. The name of the block, total, and this is the address of this block. So if I write one more statement as if I want to create a reference variable, if I want to create a reference variable for this total, how to do that means follow the syntax. First one is data type. The data type is float. Second is the reference parameter, and I can give any variable name. I'll just give the name as sum is equal to total. So now this sum and total will share the same memory location. It will share the same memory location. Is it clear? What do you mean by reference variable? Is this point clear? What do you mean by reference variable? Yes or no? I'm not hearing any responses. So just kindly unmute
the last the audio once you repeat, sir.
Okay. See, I've created a variable. I'll give one more example. I've created a variable called A. Okay. I've given some value called 5. So inside the memory block, the name of the variable is A. It is containing the value 5. We'll take that this is available at the address 1500. We'll assume that it is there in the address 1500. Now I want to create some reference for this variable A. How to create that? The first parameter is data type. data type, ampersand symbol, then I'll give the name as ABS. I'll just give the name as ABST. I'll just give the name as ABST is equal to existing variable is A. So now this is the reference variable. This is the ABST is the reference variable. A is the existing variable. Now ABST and A, they are sharing the same memory location. So they are sharing the same memory location. So if you make any changes to A, that will be reflected in ABST. If you make any changes to ABST, that will be reflected in A. Like both the variables can be used interchangeably. You can use them. Instead of A, you can use ABST. Instead of ABST, you can use A. If I go with the existing example here, so there was one variable called total, and some value 100 was stored at some location 1000. So for this, I created one reference variable called sum. See, this is the syntax to create reference variable. Now sum and total can be here. Sum and total, sum is the reference variable for existing variable total. So sum is referring to 1000 address, total is also referring to 1000 address. Like they are sharing the same memory location, so you can use total and sum interchangeably, so it doesn't matter. Clear? Understood or any other explanation is needed? Yes or no? See, 1 second, I'll just tell one.
Sir, then why have we written 100 for the existing variable, sir, in the previous example?
See, 100 is a value. 100, I've just given the value. See, instead of 100, I can write it as float. Float, what was the example? Float total is equal to, I can write it as 5 also. See, this is the value present at total, okay? So this is the value of a variable total. So memory location, name is total. So address, I'll take it as 1000. So value is 5. Now I want to create a reference to this variable called total. How to create that? Float means data type, ampersand symbol, reference name. So reference name I taken as sum is equal to, and the variable to which I want to create 100. So once I execute this line, is sum variable will be created. Here sum is the reference variable. The total was already existing. Now sum is referring to the memory location 1000. Total is also referring to the memory location 1000. So if you write total is equal to total plus 10, it's like total, earlier total contained 5. So it will be like 5 plus 10 is equal to 15. The value of total will get updated to 15. So since total and sum is sharing the same memory location, and if you print total also, you'll get the output as 15. If you access sum also, you'll get the output as 15. See, these two variables, they're referring to the same memory locations. So whatever changes you're making to total will be reflected to sum, and whatever changes you're making to sum will be reflected in total, because they're referring to the same memory location, that is 1000. So if you change the value of this 15 to 150 by using this line, total is equal to total is now 15. Let's simplify this. If you just write a line as total is equal to 150, now the value of total will become 150. So even the sum value will get updated to 150, because they are pointing to the same memory location. So you can use total instead of sum, and you can use sum instead of total. You can use these two variables interchangeably. So this we will call it as reference variable, because it is here the in our example, the sum is a reference variable. It is referring to the memory location 1000. So whatever changes you are making to the sum, that gets reflected in total. Whatever changes you are making to the total, that gets reflected in sum. Whether you are getting this, yes or no?
Yes, sir.
So we'll go with the example. So once we go with the programming example, you will be clear. Okay. So I'll just give an example for the same thing. I'll just write an example so that people will understand better. So I'll create one variable called x. And for that variable x, I'm giving the value as 10. And I'll print this c out x, then end line. So now what will be the output if I run this? If I run this, I'll get the output as 10. It is taking some time. We'll check. So the output I'm getting it as 10. So now I'll create a reference variable. Now I'll create a reference variable. How to create the reference variable? What is the syntax? Syntax is data type, ampersand symbol, reference variable name is equal to existing variable. So data type is integer. Reference ampersand. Reference variable name. You can only tell one reference variable name. I'll just take it as ref. Reference variable name. So ref is a key word. I will take it as iref. So reference variable, or I will take it as reference variable. Reference variable is equal to existing variable. Which variable is existing now in our example? X is already there. I want to create a reference for X. So I'll take it as X. Now both X and reference variable, they're pointing to the same location. So meaning if I change the value of this reference variable to 500, that will be reflected in X also. So you can check that C out reference variable and the line. So now I'll run this. See, now the reference variable, we'll just remove this line. So now initially I had given the value of X as 10. So after that I created a reference variable for this variable called X. So after that I updated the value of reference value with 500. Now once I'm trying to print this reference variable using cout statement, I'm getting the output as 500. So what will be the output if I use if I try to print now, what will be the output for 500. Yes. 500. See, you can run now. See, both are pointing to the same location, both are making the same changes. Now instead of this, I'll write it as x plus plus. So if I write it as x plus plus, and I'll print reference variable. I'll print reference variable, or I'll just take, instead of x is equal to x into 10, I'll just make x is equal to x into 10, and again I'll print reference variable. So now what output I will get? Now what I, 500 into 10 will become 5000. The value of x has been updated to 5000. Now what output I should get? Now what output I should get? Reference variable, 5, what will build the value? 5000. One second, I think build. So see, I'm getting the output as 5000. What it is happening? So what it is happening means you're able to see this screen, right? See, initially I created a variable called X. So some block, its name is X, and location, some random number. I'll give it as 1044. This is the address, okay? This is the address. This is the name. And this is the value. So for a variable X at the address 1044, I'm giving the value 10. So after this, I am creating a reference variable using this syntax. So existing variable is X. Reference variable, the name of the reference variable is refvr. Now reference variable and x will share the same memory location. What is that memory location? 1044, because I'm creating the reference for x. X is at the memory location 1044. So even reference variable will also contain the memory location 1044. So it's like at the location 1044, two variables are referring them. One is the x and the other one is reference variable. So whatever change is made by x will get reflected in reference variable. Whatever change is made by reference variable will get reflected in x. So that's why I'm increasing the value of x to x contained 10. Then I updated the value of reference variable with 500. So reference variable was at the same location. So what it will do, it will just replace this value with 500. So that's why if I printed reference variable, I was getting the output as 500. Even when I printed x, I was getting the output as 500. So after that, I made an operation x is equal to x star 10. So what was the value referred by x? X referred 500. So x into x star 10 means it's like 500 into 10. X is equal to 500 into 10. It is 5000. So again, this value was updated to 5000. So this block was referred by x. So if I try to print the reference variable or if I try to print x, they both were referring to the same memory location. So it was able to print 5000. Is this clear? The reference variable, like you can use both the variables interchangeably. So any change done through one variable will get reflected in another variable, because one is the reference of another variable. Is this point clear? Yes or no?
Yes, sir.
Okay, now, okay. This is one topic called reference variable. So few more examples are there, which I'll give in the coming classes. So how to change this? So some small modification is there. We'll check in the next classes. Remaining we'll see in the next classes. So I think the concepts are clear. Today you should be clear with polymorphism and this reference variable thing. So if anything is there, we'll check in the next classes. I'll stop now.